Hello and welcome to the newspapers. This is the show where we look at the regional papers around the country, from Scotland to Brighton. My name's Mike Mendoza and I'm joined each week by Dominic Ponsford from the Press Gazette to discuss in detail the stories that are hitting the headlines around the regions. And a welcome to you.
Hi, Mike.
Nice to see you.
Yes, so lovely. Welcome back.
Oh, thank you so much. Have you missed me?
Yes, yes. Frank Leduc's half the man you are.
Exactly, exactly. I love food,
yes,
as you may have noticed.
The only thing you need to worry about, giant slugs have invaded Nottinghamshire. Big story from last week.
Actually, a giant slug invaded my car this morning.
Yeah. Well, they've been breeding like mad. The slugs are the big story of the summer.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll remember that.
Yeah.
Let me quickly say one thing to you. You know, I've been in Europe. In Europe, they don't charge for plastic bags.
Really?
Yeah.
I hope you brought loads back in your suitcase.
I did indeed. How many would you like?
I'll only
two per each, by the way. To you.
Yeah, great. I'll have 10, please.
They're on the way. Don't worry, no problem. All right, let's look at some of the stories that are hitting the headlines around the regions. Starting off with the Birmingham Mail. So we're up in the Midlands there. BBC, three jobs moving to Birmingham in boost for city broadcasting.
Yeah, well, I thought I'd get a local take on this, the story about the future of the BBC, which has been hotly discussed this week. The government's brought forward its white paper, which basically sets out that the BBC is safe for another 11 years, up until about 2027. And basically, the nub of it is that the BBC is going to keep getting its £3.7 billion a year, thanks very much, from us, Derry taxpayer. But the Birmingham Mail has been campaigning for more of that the BBC's billions to be spent in Birmingham. Because I think back in the old days, didn't Pebble Mill used to be in Birmingham?
That's right,
they used to do daytime telly from there. But they've moved it all up to Salford, up near Manchester.
But you can understand this, because Birmingham is the Midlands, so halfway through the country, probably the ideal position.
Yeah.
Probably better than London and better than Manchester.
Yeah, well, I think it's our second city, isn't it? I think it's the second biggest city in the country, I think. So and well done, the Birmingham Mail. They've basically got BBC Three to move to Birmingham, which I think BBC Three is online only now, isn't it? But it's still got a budget of £10 million. So there's going to be a few more BBC jobs in Birmingham. And basically it goes back to a campaign they've been doing for a while. Apparently they looked at it in 2004. They found that of the £942 million raised by Midlands taxpayers, only £80 million went back into the... came back to them from the money they gave to the BBC. So, and the... BBC director, Birmingham director Joe Godwin, has basically paid tribute to the role the Birmingham Mail has said, and he said, that their manifesto they brought out for how they thought the BBC should change is it changed the conversation from a slanging match about the BBC to a critical friend's encouragement. It's been really positive. So, you know, well done then. They've kind of got stuck in and they've got a result for their readers that will bring a few more jobs to Birmingham.
I heard today that the BBC or the BBC fee may be going up another £15 very soon as well.
Yep, it's going to go up with inflation to £160, but their actual total income is going to stay flat because the BBC is going to have to start covering the cost of free TV licences for over 75s themselves. But the thing I'm really glad about is CBeebies has been saved. So that's the free nanny. That's the free nanny. That's childcare for me sorted.
Too much information.
Yeah.
The other thing, of course, is
I quite like Mr. Dumble. But
radio totally changes over to digital very soon as well. So there'll be no more AM and FM.
They're still going to try and do that, are they?
Well, they announced today, yes, it's going to move forward a bit quicker than we originally thought.
Yeah.
Well, they're meant to be switched off already, wasn't it, originally?
Yeah. I don't think it's a good idea, that. I quite like FM radio.
I like AM radio too. Mm. Okay, let's go to Belfast now as we cross the water. Attorney General challenges coerced expression in gay cake row.
Yeah, I mean, it's a difficult headline to get your head round, really, isn't it? It's quite a complicated story, this, but it's quite an interesting one. It's a pair of Christian bakers refused to put a pro-gay marriage message on a cake. So a gay activist, Gareth Lee, actually got a court order against them saying, right, if you're not going to put pro-gay marriages on cakes, then you shouldn't be in the cake business. So they're kind of actually not able to make cakes at the moment. And so it's a sort of weird freedom of speech row, but it's not over newspapers, it's over what you can ice on a cake. And it's sort of going through the courts at the moment. And they've taken it to the Court of Appeal in Belfast, and they've reserved judgment on it. But the Northern Ireland Attorney General, John Larkin, QC, has said, a person should not be forced, be it in newsprint or icing sugar, to be the mouthpiece of A's views, where B's views are opposed to those of A, if you can get it. So basically what he's saying is, What he's saying is, if you're a baker and someone wants you to write something on a cake that you don't want to write on a cake, then you shouldn't have to write it on a cake. It's quite interesting, isn't it? But it's sort of, where you draw the line on freedom of speech.
I think if a lot of people would say, well, we won't go to that baker's, we'll go to another one who will do it, surely.
Well, exactly, yeah, they'll lose that business. So maybe maybe that's a slightly more sensible way of approaching it rather than wasting lots of court time on it.
OK, the next one is the Argus in Brighton, of course. Councillors vote to halt primary school closures.
Good news. I wanted to throw this in because last week we were saying that this school was facing closure. So I thought the viewers would be pleased to see that Pells and Rodmell schools near Lewes have been saved. The councillors, good old democracy. There's been a huge backlash because obviously if you lose a village school, you know, the village is, the councillor here, so it's another nail in the coffin of the vibrancy of your village, isn't it? So they're quite small schools, and the problem is these small schools really struggle to get funding. They've hardly got any funding, and they really struggle to attract head teachers as well, because head teachers don't really want all the aggro of running a school for not very much money if it's a really small school. Mm. So, but they've been saved at the moment, and it's a sort of national issue, really, with these small village schools under threat, and the sort of government seems to be fairly alive to it, because obviously Conservatives, a lot of them represent shire counties, don't they, and where their constituents are worried about it. But it's a bit of good news in a kind of difficult time for education.
I mean, if a village, even a small village, can sustain X amount of pupils, they should continue.
Yeah, well, you know, my children go to a small village school, and it's just, you know, wonderful, and it's wonderful for the community. They all walk to school together, they know all their friends, you know, it's sustainable, isn't it? You're not driving them anywhere, you know, I think it makes sense.
I don't know if you know, but in New Zealand, all the teachers there have to go through what they call country practice. And they can go anywhere in the country into small areas to teach before they go into a mainstream school, which is a good idea.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's a good way to get head teachers out there, wouldn't it? You know, maybe make them do their service. I wouldn't mind. You know, lovely.
Hold on the front page. Campaigning Weekly helps save remote school with just 14 pupils, which is what we're talking about.
Yeah, so I mean, those ones in Lewes, 48 pupils is the smallest one, but this next one is it's got just 14 pupils at it. Can you believe it? It must be one of the smallest schools in the country, the Teesdale Mercury. You can just see the front page there, down there at the bottom, and the website Hold the Front Page.
How many classrooms they got?
Been writing about that. They must just have one, wasn't they? They must just have one teacher. I mean, that's a pretty small class size, isn't it? But, you know, just well done to the Teesdale Mercury, which ran a Fight for Forest campaign over the closure of the Forest School in County Durham. A 2,000-strong petition, and they've saved it, which is another victory for the press and for the people, I think. It was good. And so Trevor Brooks, who's the editor, he said, you know, Forest School may be small, but its importance far outweighs pupil numbers and statistics. And it helps that area remain viable by attracting young families to it. So, you know, if it was to close, it would just spell the death of that area as a living and working Dale. Obviously, that's a way of life, isn't it, that's under threat. And he particularly praised the efforts of reporter Lindsay Oxley, who worked on the campaign. So well done, Lindsay. And, you know, and she's a reporter there at a local paper who's saved a school and made a big difference for some kids and some families.
It's amazing when you look at schools, the way schools are run these days. I remember the first school I went to, the average class size was 60. Can you imagine a school now with 60 in a classroom?
I bet they used to hit you as well, did they, to keep you in order or not?
Do you know, if you were talking, like, at the back of the class, which I always normally do, the teacher would get hold of the rubber they use for the... Yeah. It was a bit of wood with a cloth on it, and throw it at you and hit you right in the head with it.
Yeah.
And they get away with it in those days.
Yeah. And it hasn't harmed you if you're completely normal.
No, nothing wrong with me. Yeah. But I used to constantly become 59th or 60th out of the class, so it's not bad. I was constant.
Yeah.
Really. You know, I'd leave and get in my place and stay in there. We get another one in, hopefully, before the break. This is from the Manchester Evening News. Please urge parents to do a better job and not use officers to scare their children.
Yeah, so this is the Fallowfield Police have posted on their Facebook page. And basically, it's in response to a father who went up to a policeman when he was out of his six-year-old and said, would you mind telling them off for being naughty? Because they won't hold my hand. And basically, the police have said, please, no, we do not want your children to be scared of us. We're the ones they should run to, not run away from them. We will protect them. They said, for the sake of your children, if you see the police, by all means point at us, but say, look, there's the police, give them a wave. But, you know, I must say I'm guilty of this as well. When I drive past Lewes Prison, I always say to my children, if you don't stop mucking about in the back, I'm going to drop you off there, because that's it gets them to quiet them down. You know, seven-year-old, the thought of a stretch in a high security prison.
That comes under child abuse, you realise that.
Well, you know.
And you've said this on camera to the whole world now. Yeah. They'll be watching you very closely.
Yeah, they'll probably sue me when they're older.
Yeah. It's funny how different stages with the police. Again, when I was young, you were taught to respect police and probably fear them, but at the same time have that respect for them. And you would always think about asking the policeman a time as well. And the policeman used to get really cheesed off. I know in London, where I was living at the time, you always went up to police and said, "Have you got time, please?"
Yeah. Or you'd ask them for directions, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you get lost, ask a policeman.
Yeah,
but I mean, yeah, that's what they were. That's what the Greater Manchester. They're trying to get that. So you know, and they're basically saying if you're unhappy with the way your child's behaving, be a parent. Set the boundaries.
Oh, come on, you're not allowed to smack your children. Certainly, you can't smack them in public anymore. You can't discipline your children. So what do?
Threaten to take them to the police.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, I'm afraid we've got a break now. You're watching the newspapers with me, Mike Mendoza, and Dominic Ponsford. We're back after the break. Don't go away. We've got a lot more stories for you from around the regions. Welcome back to the newspapers. This is where we look at the regional papers around the country with me, Mike Mendoza, and Dominic Ponsford from the Press Gazette. Well, let's have a look at some more stories that are hitting the regions today. We're off to the Eastern Daily Press, and Galston's Kevin Bacon says Hollywood's Kevin Bacon is wrong about EE after being charged £150 for a 10-hour phone call to the EDP. What is your take? So, WYM on this.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of initials. So
yes.
This is a story from Norwich, and I think it's the sort of thing that could only happen in Norfolk. There's a chap in Norfolk who's called Kevin Bacon. Mm-hmm. As you can see, he looks a little bit... The years haven't been quite as kind as the famous Kevin Bacon, who fronts the EE phone network's advertising campaigns. He's gone to war. He's gone toe-to-toe with the famous Kevin Bacon because he says he's been charged £150 for a 10-hour phone call to the Eastern Daily Press that he never made. And if you look at the photo, he's angry about it, isn't he? He's upset.
That's an angry look.
Yeah, that's
scary.
That's local newspaper angry person look. So anyway, he's gone to the EDP and they've raised it with...
He looks really worried.
They phrased it with everything everywhere. And the good old local paper, they've got a result. He's got a full refund and an apology and also a month's free line rental. So they saw that 66-year-old Norfolk Kevin Bacon was not a man to be messed with, and they certainly didn't want to put him in a room with famous Kevin Bacon because it would have gone disastrously wrong. But I quite enjoy this story because the... Everything Everywhere, or EE, I think, as they're called now, spokesman. They basically got into the spirit of this story, and they said it was the excessive bill was caused by a technical fault. And if you get their spokesman, you'll watch the pun. So their spokesman said, "Mr. Bacon may have had tremors when his bill arrived," which is a film, Kevin Bacon. "But we're not footloose and fancy free with our customers' money. We immediately sent the bill for recalculation and offered a gesture of goodwill by way of apology." So it's a good job they can see the funny side about overcharging people by £150.
Yeah. The other thing, of course, is the power of the press. What would have happened if the press wasn't involved in this? Would this man got his £150 back? Would they have actually admitted the mistake? The amount of times people have to go to the press... to radio, television, or the print media to get some sort of result.
Yeah, well, people don't realise that. Yeah, when you work on a local paper, lots of stories never get printed because you phone up, complain on the punter's behalf, and the person says, "Oh, we'll sort that out for you." And the person that phoned you up with the original story says, "Actually, I don't want to do it now." So you're constantly sorting things out, and it's people with problems in their council houses, people with problems with the utilities, and like you say, I mean, that's what. We face losing, unfortunately, with all the thousands of local newspaper journalists who sadly lost their jobs in the last few years. And so that's why everyone's got to buy local newspapers and keep them going. It's so important.
I had an instance a few years ago when I was working on radio, and luckily it was a pretty high-profile radio show, where I had someone knock on my door to hand me a summons for something... Actually, it was non-payment of council tax for an area I'd never lived in and for a house I'd never lived in either. Mm. But he would not accept me as being the wrong person. Mm. When I phoned the council up, they said, "Sorry, it's all done. This is where they've chased you and that and that." So I said, "Well, it's not me. It doesn't matter." Then I went to someone else, didn't want to know, the agents, he didn't want to know. Mm. So when I went on air that night, I phoned the mayor up, by the way, and also chief executive, and said, "Listen to my show at midnight tonight." And at 1:30 in the morning, they'd fired the tracing agency, fired the bailiff company, and I got a full apology.
Very good.
Apology.
Very good.
But if I hadn't been in that situation, when no one was prepared to talk to me, what happened?
Yeah.
The exactly. power of the media, folks. That's what we're here for. Yes. Okay, the next one is South Wales Evening Post. Watch the moment Dad is knocked out by clown when circus trick goes horribly wrong.
Yeah, I mean, there's a video to
it's
go...
It's not that funny, really.
Well, there's a video to go with this, but I don't think we're going to show the video because it's just far too harrowing. And I think we go out pre-watershed. But it's sort of your worst nightmare, isn't it, really? I mean, I think a lot of people find clowns quite frightening anyway at the best of times. But this guy, Ben Gardam, age 37, he took his two daughters to the circus. He was pulled out of the crowd by a clown. I think he was expecting to be squirted with some water or something. But the clown wanted to get him to do a sort of tumble with him. And he explains it. He says, it's all a bit of a blur, but he pushed against the back of my legs, and that was the last thing I remember. And he said, I thought he was going to squirt water over me or something, but it looked like a wrestling move. And if you see the video, the guy's actually flipped on his back, and he's knocked out absolutely cold. Mm. And they actually drag him away, and he spent the night in hospital. And he said, basically, they could have paralysed me for life. I'm so lucky. I would have seen the funny side. He said, no, I wouldn't have seen the funny side if I'd been paralysed from the neck down or dead. So it was rather a shocking story, isn't it?
But it's sort of the next thing is the compensation case, I guess.
I would think so, yeah. Circus Zaire, yeah. Which is heading to Carmarthen this weekend. So I think, don't
sure
volunteer,
you volunteer
for it.
Don't volunteer for it.
Don't
you
volunteer
make a fortune
for it.
Out of it.
That's a good advice for life, isn't it? Don't volunteer for anything a clown asks you to do.
I hate to bring up my own experiences, but I did a clown act once in a shopping centre, and one of the things I had to do was get all the kids watching at school holidays, and I got a kid up on the stage, a line of kids, and they had to drink a whole can of fizzy drink, a famous one, which I won't mention, and some sugar, and then blow up a balloon, and one child just passed out. And I thought, oh my God, that scared the hell out of me, I tell you.
Maybe
that's in the days before compensation.
Maybe they'd never had the fizzy drink before. Maybe the sugar rush overwhelmed
them. That's what it was, that and blowing into the balloon didn't help. Okay, next one. Is this the best response to a critical TripAdvisor review ever? Scunthorpe Telegraph.
Yeah, so good old TripAdvisor. I mean, I'm sure you went on TripAdvisor before you booked your cruise. I don't know, did you?
But no, I didn't. But I am a constant reviewer on TripAdvisor. Well, even places I've never been to.
Well, so the landlord of this North Lincolnshire pub, the Britannia Inn, has basically got a really bad TripAdvisor review, and he's not taking it. Lying down. So basically, the customer gave him one star because they said they got back from London on Sunday evening. 7:30, and they told us the food stopped serving at 8 p.m. Oh dear, one star, which is kind of probably North Lincolnshire. It's not central London, isn't it? Probably 8 p.m. seems like a reasonable time to stop serving food on a Sunday. People have got to go to bed, haven't they? So and then it turns out he previously posted a 3-star review, in which he condemned the lack of choice and having to wait 40 minutes for his food. Mr. Brigg, the landlord, said, "Good evening, sir." After reading your reviews, I've decided to respond. He said, "I've written your first review, which took me half a day to read."
Is that a Lincolnshire accent, by the way?
I can't do Lincolnshire. Dimly know where it is. He said, "It took me half a day to read. It was that intense." And basically he goes on to say, "Your latest review of one of our competitors, you slated us. That's libel, my friend." And then he says, "It's personal now." He goes on. He says, basically, I said, "I looked at all your other reviews. There are 175, by the way. I bet the cold winter nights must just fly by in your house." And he says, "I realise you go as far as reviewing a kebab shop." So I laughed and gave up. But then he gets quite nasty at the end. He says, so "let's reach an agreement. I won't report you to TripAdvisor for slander and or slate you on Facebook. And you can stay away from our hostelry for the foreseeable future. Sounds fair?" The landlord. So he's barred him. You imagine publicans must get quite annoyed with these reviews.
Just a warning to anybody who does put a review on TripAdvisor, you are named on there, so you can't do it anonymously.
Yeah. So oh, really? Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder what Basil Fawlty would have made of TripAdvisor.
Yes.
He would have been good, wouldn't he?
I'm very cautious what I do put on there because I say you are identified. Let's go up to Manchester now. The Manchester Evening News battled to reveal how BBC spent £110,000 on free tea and coffee for Salford staff in just 1 year. That's quite cheap, 110,000.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think it's probably slightly more than latest TV spends on tea and coffee. But having tasted the tea and coffee here, I'll be surprised.
Have you noticed your tea, coffee and croissants have sort of slowed down a bit since you first started here?
I'm slightly worried about that, yeah. Yeah, they've dried up. So, I mean, this is an FOI battle from the Manchester Evening News to find out how much BBC Salford spent on tea and coffee. But I suppose, it looks like it's one of those things they kind of throw in these FOI requests, and they just thought, well, it'd make a little story. But for some reason, the BBC refused to answer it, and they basically said it would damage its commercial interests to reveal how much tea and coffee they give to people. So they had a 16-month battle over it, which, in itself is probably...
Is this a legal requirement by the FOIs?
Well, the BBC,
Well, anyone. If I went to a local authority or to, let's say, the BBC, ITV, anyone at all, and put in FOI, do they have to respond?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Maybe within 2 weeks. Any public authority, broadly, provided the public interest in disclosing it outweighs the public interest in keeping it secret.
Oh, okay.
So, but I think with the BBC, because it's public money, it's our money, they have to tell us how they spend it. So anyway, after 16 months and going to the Freedom of Information Commission, they finally got the answer. Initially, the BBC would only tell them the brands they used, which included Twinings Earl Grey, which sounds a bit decadent, doesn't it? So it turns out they spend £300 a day providing free tea and coffee to BBC staff and their visitors at Salford Quays.
But you expect it, don't you, when you work somewhere? You expect tea and coffee at the least.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, I'm not quite sure what the Manchester Evening News are driving out with this one. But
there's some spare space to fill.
I mean, there's 2,700 staff there. But I guess, in a way, the question is why the BBC doesn't just cough up this money. Their accounts should just be public, shouldn't they? It's our money, it's public money. They should just be open, shouldn't they? We should be able to find out how every penny of it is spent. Why hide it?
I spend £3,500 a year on coffee, by the way. Just want to let you know. Well, that's all we've got time for today, I'm afraid. Thanks for your company. For me, Mike Mendoza and Dominic Ponsford. We'll see you again very soon. Maybe next week if you're around. Bye for now.